Sherlock Holmes is probably the most famous detective in the world. From books to board games all the way to movies and TV shows, it's almost impossible to be unaware of this massive British icon created by Arthur Conan Doyle. I mean, there's even a pub in London named after him. By the way, they do a pretty good fish and chip. But Sherlock also has plenty of video games under his belt, and most of them are pretty good, even the more recent ones despite being a bit outdated. I haven't played them in years, but I do have some pretty good memories with them. These games have never been groundbreaking, award-winning experiences, but for fans of investigations and murder mysteries, they do scratch this particular itch quite well. And that's exactly what I was looking for in Sherlock Holmes Chapter 1. When I saw the first gameplay footage for that game, I was hopeful that it was going to be a step towards true greatness for the franchise. So, was I right, or is it a step backwards? That's what we're gonna find out. But first, a quick word about the sponsor of this video. If you're looking for an easy and simple way to find good, royalty-free music for your videos, then Artlist is the place to go. By the way, all the music you're going to hear in today's episode actually comes from Artlist, so that gives you an idea of what you're getting. And if music is not your thing, then there's ArtGrid, which is the alternative platform for video footage. Their websites are super well done, their catalog is huge, it grows every single day, and the quality of what you're getting is just insane. So to all my content creators out there, I highly suggest that you check them out. If you're interested and also want to support the channel at the same time, use the links down below and get 2 extra free months added to your subscription. With all that being said, let's talk about Sherlock Holmes Chapter 1. Chapter 1 is a brand new open world adventure featuring a young Sherlock struggling to prove himself as he navigates an exotic and dangerous island to investigate the mystery of his mother's death. This is a much more personal story. There's a big emphasis on memories in this game. You get to see key moments in Sherlock's life, but also witness how he became the arrogant genius we've grown to love over the years. Because yes, he's just as cocky, eccentric, and overconfident as he's always been. But at the same time, he's younger and more naive in some ways, which makes him really interesting as a character. And on top of that, there's also John, and I'm not talking about John Watson. This John is quite mysterious because he's kind of like Sherlock's imaginary childhood friend and acts as a sounding board for him. He will comment on your discoveries, help you untangle your memories, and drop in a couple of jokes from time to time. And the writing is quite excellent in this game. It's funny, it's clever, there's a strong sense of mystery, and it's extremely British. Aside from the main missions, there's also plenty of secondary tales which have you roaming around the island to solve various crimes. This is really fun because those give you an excuse to explore and to learn more about the place where Sherlock grew up. And this is a beautiful location. At first, I wasn't sure about the idea of a Sherlock Holmes game set in a sunny paradise island, but Cardona is a really nice change of pace and allows for absolutely gorgeous vistas. And do not worry, there is also a much sinister side to this island that you will get to explore with politics, corruption, and violence. Generally speaking, this is a breath of fresh air. There's a day-night cycle, and the island is divided into districts, each with a unique architecture and atmosphere. From a visual standpoint, I'd say this is a big improvement over the previous games, the console versions at least. The lighting can be surprisingly impressive, the character animations are pretty good, overall it's just a very slick looking game. Unfortunately, on the technical side, there's still some problems. Your journey will be punctuated with a bunch of visual glitches here and there and some performance issues. Although the game manages to keep a steady 60 FPS inside the various buildings, the moment you set foot in the open world, that's when things get a bit more uneven. You do get a lot of stuttering, which can make exploring large chunks of the island a tiny bit annoying from time to time, and it's also in the open world, especially when there's a lot of trees and foliage, that most visual glitches will occur. But this is something that can be very easily fixed through updates, so I'm not too worried. What cannot be so easily fixed though is the facial animations. This has always been the number one problem of every single Sherlock Holmes games in my opinion, and sadly there's still a lot of work that needs to be done. And since dialogue is one of the key gameplay pillars, you'll see faces very often. Still, it remains much better than what we saw in Frogwares' previous game, The Sinking City. Facial animations are more even, and the character models are more detailed and lifelike. Nonetheless, if there's one area where they can definitely improve in the future, is this one. But obviously, what matters most with a detective game is the gameplay, and there's a lot to say here. Usually, I feel like most games of this genre hold the player by the hand way too much. In something like LA Noire, for instance, there's barely any deduction work that needs to be done, and the game constantly dictates the next steps in your investigation. You will pretty much never end up scratching your head, which isn't the case with a game like The Sinking City, for instance. And despite its numerous flaws, that game had some very compelling investigations. And Chapter 1 follows in the same footsteps. This is the kind of experience that rewards patience and observation. This game believes that you can come to conclusions on your own and that you do not always need to be told what to do. For example, the game never gives waypoints to follow. If you want to go somewhere, you need to search on the map, ask people for direction, and let street names and landmarks guide you around. There's also no fail state. No matter the decisions you make, the game will react according to these decisions. And the solutions are oftentimes not as easy as they might seem. Frequently, I found myself looking at all the evidence I gathered in the Mind Palace or in my casebook for like 10 minutes straight while trying to piece things together and truly understand every detail of the investigations. What helps in creating a solid mystery is that there's always more than one suspect. Usually, in these types of games, the one who's guilty becomes extremely obvious as you progress, but in Chapter 1, even when I was right in the middle of an accusation, I wasn't exactly sure of what I was doing, and that says a lot about the game. For every case, there's multiple characters you can accuse, each of them with more than one potential motive, and you can even decide to arrest them or let them go. And once you've made your decision, sometimes it's even unclear if you made the right call or not. The stories are very well crafted and have enough nuance to offer the players a proper puzzle that will ask you to actually think and come up with theories, which I loved. If you're not familiar with this type of game though, you might be a little bit overwhelmed and frustrated over some of the cases, but if you've always wanted more freedom in your murder mysteries, then this is it. Plus, the difficulty options really allow you to customize how much clues you want. Do you want some minor hints, or do you want to figure absolutely everything out by yourself? The choice is yours. Chapter 1 has 5 main cases and over 30 side missions you can pick up in the open world. And don't worry, they're not random bullshit, they're all small investigations or pieces of forgotten memories. I enjoyed pretty much every single piece of content the game had to offer. One thing I particularly liked was picking up unfinished investigations at the police station. The reason why I felt this was interesting is because you need to solve the crimes after an investigation has already been conducted. So when you pick up a mission at the board, you get a bunch of evidence and testimonies and need to study what's been done before you and get to know everyone involved. Really fun and engaging stuff. I haven't finished the game yet, so I can't tell how long it is to complete, but according to the developers, the main quest takes around 10 to 12 hours to complete, but if you want to do everything in the game, expect around 40 hours of playtime. And judging by my current progress in the game, I'd say this isn't too far off. But before coming up with any conclusion whatsoever, you need to do the investigations and collect evidence. And Sherlock has a bunch of tools at his disposal. First of all, like any good detective, you will start by observing the environment and picking up clues. This is pretty standard stuff, it's similar to what you would find in games like LA Noire. You pick up objects, turn them around, find important details, things like that. But observation becomes really interesting with the concentration mode, which replicates Sherlock's ability to use his imagination to piece things together in his mind. Basically, you'll be able to recreate scenes based on specific environmental clues in order to understand what happened to the people involved. This feature reminded me a lot of Return of the Obra Dinn. In that game, you needed to uncover the fate of every crew member of a ship gone missing. This includes their names, where and how they met their fate, who their killer was, as well as their location. And here, the system is very similar. You need to pay attention to people's look, you need to carefully read testimonies, and also need to observe the environment. Even though it does suffer from some visibility issues in my opinion, this system was a freaking blast to play and represented one of my favorite parts of every investigation. Then, when you're done gathering clues, it's time to talk to witnesses. Once again, standard stuff, you ask questions, you present evidence, you get the idea. You can approach virtually anyone and ask them about the information you're looking for. But where Chapter 1 truly shines is with its costume mechanic. Like I said, the island is divided into multiple districts, and some of them are richer than others. And if you go around a poor neighborhood with your tuxedo on, chances are no one is gonna wanna talk to you, which is why you need to disguise yourself. And this goes beyond the simple act of changing clothes. You can apply makeup, and you can even dress as a woman. You also have the ability to profile people to reveal personal attributes, friendliness towards you, as well as general character traits. So if you talk to a sailor, for example, Sherlock will change his voice to fit in. This is a surprisingly deep mechanic, and once again, if you don't pay close attention to every detail, it's very easy to blow your cover. But don't worry, if you get stuck, you can also visit the various archives at your disposal. You can search for old newspaper articles, autopsy reports, legal paperwork, and much more. Honestly, the amount of tools at your disposal is very impressive. Switching between all of them is extremely engaging, and when you finally get the eureka moment, it feels absolutely great. Lastly, I want to talk really quickly about combat, because yes, combat is in the game. Sometimes you will be given the choice to use brute force instead of talking your way through. And combat isn't that great, to be honest. I mean, it's functional, but it's much closer to a minigame that revolves around hitting weak points, stunning enemies, and quick time events rather than a fully fledged combat system. I don't think it was necessary, but if you like it, there's bandit lairs you can clear out for some additional playtime, and if you really don't like it, you can simply skip it. In the end, I had a lot of fun with Sherlock Holmes Chapter 1. With a few updates, this could easily be one of my favorite detective games in recent memory. It's a challenging experience that isn't an insult to the player's intelligence, and for that reason alone, it's definitely worth a try. Thank you guys so much for watching, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to like and subscribe, and you can also support the channel on Ko-fi or by picking up an Artlist or Artgrid subscription via the links in the description. Follow me on Twitter if you want updates and see me rambling about video games, and also join me on the Discord server if you want to chat. That's pretty much it, and I'll see you guys later.